I will be speaking on management of the post-penetrating keratoplasty high astigmatism. The cases which we will be talking are after suture removal, and that too 6 months have passed after suture removal. I don't have any financial interest, and astigmatism is one of the most common causes of suboptimal vision after corneal transplantation, despite having a very good graft. And as we know, above 5 diopter astigmatism, the optical correction becomes very difficult and it needs to be handled by some other measures. The factors influencing the amount of astigmatism after keratoplasty are the severity of the underlying disorder like keratoconus, eccentric trephination, graft and donor size disparity, corneal thickness mismatch between the two, and also the suturing technique of the surgeon. The first thing we should do is examination of a patient, best corrected visual acuity, uncorrected visual acuity, and most important with the other gadgets is the slit lamp biomicroscopy, so as to evaluate the graft size, centration, clarity, and graft host interface. Optical corrections above 5 diopters is very difficult to do, and the other methods which can be done, as is the topic is refractive surgery revisited, I will skip off the other methods. So incisional keratotomy is done. Initially it was done by manual, nowadays it is done with the femto. Here the paired femto incisions are given, and they are given inside the graft. And because the new limbus has been created, so it gives a better result. And it is given in the steepest corneal meridia. And if the astigmatism amount is very high, then some traction sutures are to be given in the opposite meridia. Other methods which can correct are basically carings or intacts, but the problem is that sometimes there is a wound dehiscence between the graft and the host because of the pressure put while doing the intacts. Then wedge resection, initially it was done manually, nowadays it is done by the femtosecond, but here no set nomograms are there, and it can also cause micro-perforations and also the wound dehiscence. Here the amount of astigmatism corrected is around about 0.05 millimeter to 1.1 millimeter wedge resection will give almost a 1 diopter of astigmatism correction. And sutures are also given and 2 edges are approximated. These sutures are removed after the 6 months. Then comes the phakic IOL, and but phakic IOLs become very dangerous in these cases, as keratoplasty has been done and the loss of endothelial cells is very high, almost it is reported to 25 to 30%. Then clear lens exchange, toric IOLs to be done, and smart toric IOL which has been manufactured by one of our Indian company. Besides this, ICL is one of the method of choice in which toric ICL can be done, and in very bad cases repeat keratoplasty. Now, the most promising method, which in my view is the laser refractive surgery. The laser refractive surgery, 1997, the first case of LASIK was reported in post-KP keratoplasty. But people think that PRK is much safer because there are no complications regarding the flap, and femto-LASIK, or we can also combine with the LASIK extra. Now, I will present my case study. This is a 36-year-old patient with history of penetrating keratoplasty 14 years back in right eye for keratoconus. Patient presented with decreased vision, uniocular and binocular diplopia, and besides this, patient's family life was very bad, his social condition was bad, he was on suicidal tendencies, he was not able to move in the night because of high level of astigmatism as well as anisometropia. On examination, the right eye showed a scar of keratoplasty, but graft was very clear. Refraction and acceptance in right eye was minus 1.5 with minus 6, and vision was 612, and left eye it was minus 1.75 sphere with minus 3.25 cylinder at 110 degree. So very gross degree of anisometropia was there. This is a pre-op picture of the patient. You can see a very thick scar on the upper side, and which was amounting to it. And secondly, we can also observe there was a eccentric graft, and this is a pre-op topography of the patient. Now the patient acceptance was minus 6, but we were not able to give more than minus 4.5 of cylinder, But topography showed us cylinder of almost 10 diopters, 40.7K and 50.3K. So 10 diopters was the astigmatism. So we thought to do the surgical procedure. It was a femtolasic extra. Now why to do a femto? Why not we can do for a bleed lasic? Basically there was 40 and 50K. There were chances of either a free cap or either a button holing, and examiner definitely to correct the refractive error. And as the FDA approval is up to 6 diopters, we did the 6 diopter correction, and we did the accelerated C3R because there are many reports which say that in very high astigmatism, in high refractive error, one can go for the enhanced C3R. So this is a post treatment. Here we can see clear mark, and this is a graft. This is post-op topography. I have taken series of post-op topographies because patient was operated 2 years, and this is an OCT which shows a clearly a flap as well as the host and graft margins. This is a post topography recently done. Here all we can see is the all the aberration values has gone down, and now the astigmatism is amounting to 4.5. K1 is 41 and this is 46. Now the patients follow up after, this is an old slide, but even then here after 2 years the follow up is the same. Uncorrected visual acuity is 618 and best corrected visual acuity by minus 2.5 diopter cylinder is 6/6. So in conclusion, we have very large armamentarium of refractive surgery to correct post-keratoplasty astigmatism. However, none of them appear as a perfect option, and corneal surgeons should tailor a specific plan on the basis of patient needs and clinical situation to take the advantage of each intervention. Thank you.